Good day, dear students, and welcome back to our English class. Yesterday we had started with this play called The Miracle Merchant, and today we are going to be continuing with it. Now, I told you that this play is written by this author called Sakhi, and that's his pen name. His real name is Hector Hugh Munro, and this was actually a short story that he had written, but then he converted it into a play because there is scope for a lot of dialogues and a lot of drama, right? And we've seen that the story is about this household. There is this very wealthy woman named Mrs. Beauvaisseau, and she has a country house, and it is set somewhere in the Edwardian era. And I wish to correct myself here. I had told you that the Edwardian era is probably the 1800s, but that's not the case. The Edwardian era is the 1900s onwards. Okay, so the story is set somewhere in the beginning of the 20th century, that is 1900 onwards. Okay, we're not told which year exactly. Okay, and yes, of course. Edwardian era, it is named after the ruler of that time. So King Edward succeeded Queen Victoria, who passed away in the year 1901, and Edwardian era starts with King Edward taking over the throne. Okay, now the society there was used to the living that we're talking about. So they had big houses, a lot of money, a lot of stages, and nothing to do other than to spend all of their money and enjoy themselves. Okay, the story that we have here is also something similar, but I also brought you a picture of so that you can visualize this better. So this is one nice Edwardian country house. So the story is set in a house like this. It's huge, and it has got these French windows. French windows are these windows again. It's I have another picture here. So windows like these with which has glass in it, and they're long enough. They're actually French windows, but they're long enough to be doors, so you can open it, and they have a opening here in the middle. Okay, so these are French windows, and of course these references are made in the play, so it's nice to picture it this way. So this is the French window we have on the right hand side of the stage, and on the left hand side, like we were talking about yesterday, we have a staircase, and underneath that staircase is the wooden paneling with the swords and the daggers, and you know, next to that also is a stand for the golf clubs and everything, right? So that is the stage setting, and I hope you've not forgotten that there was a table right in front with the breakfast still on it, and there was a butler. His name is Sturridge. That butler keeps coming and filling in any item that is eaten up or that is drunk. So if there's coffee that is over, he comes and fills that up, right? And so this is Mrs. Beauvaisseau's house, but at the moment or when the story takes place or when the scene is set, she is entertaining a guest, and the name of that guest is Jane Martlett. Now Jane Martlett is not necessarily related to Mrs. Beauvaisseau, but you know, that is just the tendency that they have. Since they have so much of money, they entertain a lot of guests. So it's almost been 6 days that Jane Martlett has been living at Mrs. Beauvaisseau's place, and it's not the first time that she has come here to stay over with Mrs. Beauvaisseau. She's done it plenty of times before. All right, and there is another person in the house, that is Louis Corset. Louis is related to Mrs. Beauvaisseau here. Louis is the nephew of Mrs. Beauvaisseau, and we are told that he keeps asking his aunt for money. At the start of the play, we are told that he secretly goes to his aunt and asks for £20, and it's also indicated to us that this is not the first time he's doing it. He's done it previously as well, and the aunt usually gives him the money, but this time she puts a foot down and she says, I've had a lot of expenses and I can't afford to even give you £5, okay, so let alone £20, right? And they are conversing about it, and then suddenly the auntie tells him that there is this new guest by the name of Dora Bittholz, who has written a letter to her saying that she will be visiting Mrs. Beauvaisseau's house the next Thursday. So say suppose we are on a Saturday or a Sunday of this particular week, the coming week on Thursday Dora Bittholz will be arriving. right? And that is when the nephew, that is Lewis, he says that this is not entirely good news, because Jane Martlet and Dora Bithold had been friends, but now they're sworn enemies. They hate each other. Okay, and if Dora Bithold comes, Jane Martlet will still be there in Mrs. Boveson's house. Why? Because Jane Martlet has the habit of overstaying. Now, she has written to say that she will only stay for 6 days, but always she stays for at least a fortnight, which is about 14 or 15 days, about 2 weeks, right? And so they say that although her 6 days are up, she's not going to leave. She's going to wait till the end of the next week, and only then she will leave and go wherever else, either to her own home or to some other friend's place or whatever. Okay, so Lewis makes his aunt aware of the situation, that it's going to be very awkward, and there's going to be a lot of drama under our roof. Okay, because Dora Bithold and Jane Martlet will be in the same place. Okay, and we had stopped here where we were talking about why have these best friends now become sworn enemies? Why do they hate each other so much? And we are told that a hen has come between them. The reason why they are upset is not because of a man, as everyone would have expected, but it's because of a hen. Now, then of course, Mrs. Boveson says, "A hen? What hen?" And Lewis explains. He says, "It was a bronze leghorn or some such exotic breed, and Dora sold it to Jane at a rather exotic price. They both go in for poultry breeding, you know." So the story is that there is a bronze leghorn. Bronze is just the color of that leghorn breed of hens. And we know that leghorns are usually known for laying eggs. They are known for their capacity to lay eggs. Okay, so this particular breed was even, it had much higher expectations of laying eggs. Okay, so therefore the price of this bird was also very high. So what had happened is Dora had sold that leghorn to Jane. Okay, at a very exotic price, because it was not an ordinary hen. So there was this expectation that it will lay a lot of eggs, and Jane will do very good business by selling those eggs. Okay, because they are into poultry breeding. Okay, so they breed birds. They make sure that more and more birds are born, and they sell that bird, and also probably the eggs that come from it, they sell that as well. Okay, but more of breeding, more of creating opportunities for more and more hens to be born. That is what they are into. That is the business that they run. Okay, that's a side business. Then so yes, of course, the deal is done, and Dora has sold the bird for a very high price to Jane. Now, in order for Jane to be able to continue, getting more and more birds or more and more hens of the same breed, this bronze leghorn needs to lay an egg. Okay, and that is how it will continue, right? That is how that business also will succeed, right? But we are told here, so Mrs. Boveson says, if Jane agreed to give the price, I don't see what there was to quarrel about. So you're saying that the bird was there. She was an exotic bird. She was an extraordinary bird. And the deal was done. Jane paid the price, the exotic price, a very high price. Then what is the problem? Why did they fight? Then Lewis goes on to explain. He says, well, you see, the bird turned out to be an abstainer from the egg habit. Okay, and I'm told that the letters which passed between the two women were a revelation as to how much abuse could be got on a sheet of notepaper. So the problem was this: although the bird was sold at a very high price and it was bought at a very high price, the bird was of no use to anyone because the bird refused to lay an egg. An abstainer from the egg habit means it did not lay eggs at all. That was the problem. And it's very unusual, but it happened to be the case with this particular bronze leghorn bird or hen. Okay, and as a result of that, because Jane paid so much of money for it, now what use is it? Because the bird is not going to lay eggs. It's of no use to anybody, right? So she was upset with her best friend having done this to her and cheated her this way. And again, we're not sure whether Dora knew about it, whether Dora did this on purpose, or whether she innocently sold this bird, not knowing that this bird had, did not have the tendency to lay eggs. We are not sure about that. Okay. What we know is that as a result of this bad incident, a lot of letters had been passed between the two women, revealing how much abuse could be got onto a sheet of paper. Now, this is a little funny because they're trying to say that they didn't speak to each other, but they wrote letters, and in that letter, they started abusing each other. They started saying all kinds of bad and evil things about each other. Okay, they started insulting each other, defaming each other. So all that anger has come out because they both feel that they cheated the other person. So Mrs. Bovisel says, how ridiculous. Couldn't some of their friends compose the quarrel? So the problem is, why did it become such a big issue? Other people could not have interfered and stopped the quarrel between the two friends. You know, why is it so bad that till today, they are sworn enemies because of that one small incident? So Lewis says it would have been rather like composing the storm music of a Wagner opera. Jane was willing to take back some of her most libellous remarks if Dora would take back the hen. So there was no way in which they could calm the quarrel between the two friends, Lewis tells her, because they are just too upset about everything. Okay, and the quarrel was somewhat like the storm music of a Wagner opera. Wagner is the surname of a great man. I think his name is Richard Wagner. He writes opera music. Okay, so it's a lot of intensity and a lot of highs, high-pitched. Okay, opera music that he prepares, storm music that he prepares. Okay, so that quarrel was like that. You know, high-pitched. It's a lot of tension there. Okay, so Lewis is just playing on the word compose here. He's trying to say, you know, it's like composing the storm music of a Wagner opera. Their quarrel was like the Wagner opera. What Mrs. Bovisel meant by the word compose is not to create, but to calm down, the word compose. But Lewis takes it in a different way. He's playing on the word compose, and he's trying to tell you that the quarrel that was going on between the two friends was like the storm music of a Wagner opera. It was that intense. Okay, so this is a brilliant use of pun. Pun is a play on the word. One person means it in a particular way, but the other person takes it in a completely different way. Okay, so Jane, and we are told finally that Jane was willing to take back some of her most libellous remarks, some of her most defamatory, you know, most insulting remarks that she had written about Dora, if Dora would take back the hen. So that is like a fair enough deal. Jane said, okay, fine, I'll take back my words, but Dora has to take back the hen and give me the money that I paid for the hen. Okay, so Mrs. Bovisel says, and wouldn't she? So wouldn't Dora take back the hen? And Lewis says, not she. She said that would be owning herself in the wrong. And you know that Dora would never, under any circumstances, own herself in the wrong. She would as soon think of owning a slum property in Whitechapel as do that. Now, we are told something about Dora, although she is not a character present on stage. Dora is one person who does not, she does not like admitting her mistake. And here also we are told that Dora said, I am not taking back that bronze leg on hen, because if I take it back, it shows that I did this on purpose and I was wrong. Okay, so I am not wrong. I have not done anything wrong. So I'm not taking back the hen because it was not my fault, whatever happened with the hen. Okay. And why does Dora do it? Because she really does not have the habit of admitting her mistake. Owning herself in the wrong means she just does not like saying that she committed a mistake or that she did something wrong. Okay? She would as soon as think of owning a slum property in Whitechapel as do that. Whitechapel is a place that had a lot of Jews living in there. I'm sure you're aware of Jews that they're, and especially Christians, they are always arguing with each other because they are related, but they are they have some main issues on which they disagree upon. So Hitler was a Catholic person, and Jews, so there was this divide between them. They did not like each other. Okay, So we are assuming that this is a Christian household, and Lewis is trying to exaggerate. He's trying to say that, you know what, she being a Christian, she might go and own, she might go and buy a property which belongs to, or which has so many Jews living on it, but she will never own her own mistake. Again, he's playing on the word own. Okay, he's just trying to show what Dora is, that she's not going to accept her mistake. Mrs. Bovisel says, it will be a most awkward situation having them both under my roof at the same time. Do you suppose they won't speak to one another? So she's worried because she's the host, right? It is her house, and she is the hostess or host for both of these young women. Okay, so she says, do you think that now if Dora comes to my house, because Jane Martlett is not leaving, they will speak to each other or they will not speak to each other? What is the situation? Lewis says, on the contrary, the difficulty will be to get them to leave off. Their descriptions of each other's conduct and character have hitherto been governed by the fact that only 4 ounces of plain speaking can be sent through the post for a penny. Okay, so the question specifically was, do you suppose they won't speak to one another? Okay, if they both see each other, will they not talk to one another? And Lewis says, I am scared that when they actually meet each other face to face, they will speak too much. You will not be able to stop them. Why is this going to be the case? Because so far they have not met each other face to face. They have only been able to write letters to each other. And even those letters, it would have been full and they would have written many more pages if it was not expensive. We are told only 4 ounces. Ounces is a quantity of plain speaking can be sent through the post for a penny. So it costs a lot of money if you want to keep writing insults to the other person. So as a result of that, of the money factor here, they have reduced their abuses or their insults for each other. Okay, so that's what he says, that their descriptions of each other's conduct is behavior and character, have hitherto so far been controlled by the fact that only a small amount of writing can be sent through the post for a penny. Okay, otherwise they could have even written a book of the amount of anger and abuses that they have for each other. Okay, so now if you are telling me that they are both going to meet in your house, Lewis is trying to tell her that they will argue, they are going to keep making the best use of it because it is free, they are not paying to speak, right? They're just going to see each other face to face. So it's going to be a very difficult situation. It's not a good idea for both of them to meet each other. That is what he's trying to tell his aunt. Mrs. Bovisel, what is to be done? I can't put Dora off. I've already postponed her visit once, and nothing short of a miracle would make Jane leave before her self-allotted fortnight is over. So she is all worked up, Mrs. Bovisel, as the host, right? And she says, I could have told Dora to come some other time. I could have postponed her visit because Jane is already here and, she has this thing of she's going to stay for another 6 days, right? So she says that I can't put Dora off again. I can't postpone her visit off again. Why? Because I've already postponed it once before. Okay, so the only thing is to get Jane out of the house because Dora has to come to this place. There is no option there, but Jane has to leave. Okay, and with Jane, what is the problem? She will not leave unless her fortnight is over, her self-allotted fortnight, because in her letter she only writes that she's going to stay for 6 days, but out of her own will she decides that she will leave only after her fortnight is over. So only a miracle will make her change this habit that she has and make her leave before her fortnight is over. And Lewis, seeing the opportunity, he says, I don't mind trying to supply a miracle at short notice. Miracles are rather in my line. So he says, you want a miracle, no? You want that Jane Martlett should leave our house and go? Don't worry, I will supply that miracle, and that too at short notice, because Thursday is coming quite soon. So before Thursday comes, Jane Martlett has to go, okay? So Lewis is boasting. He says, miracles are rather my line. So I'm very good at this. I keep helping people and I keep bringing miracles, keep giving miracles to them. Okay, so Mrs. Bovisel says, my dear Lewis, you'll be clever if you get Jane out of this house before Thursday. So she says very nicely as an aunt, she says, I will consider you as a very clever person if by some ingenious trick you manage to get Jane Martlet out of this house before Thursday. And of course, by not being rude, you can't just tell her to get out because where are your manners? You've got to be very polite and still make sure that Jane gets out of the house. So Louis says, I shall not only be clever, I shall be rich. In sheer gratitude, you will say to me, Louis, I love you more than ever. And here are the 20 pounds we were speaking about. Okay, so Louis is not going to do anything for free. He says, I'm not only going to be clever if I manage to get Jane Martlet out of this house, I'm also going to be rich. Why? Because in return for the miracle that I'm going to provide you, you are going to pay me. Okay, it's not free. You're going to pay me and you're going to give me the 20 pounds that I had asked you earlier. So that is how he becomes a miracle merchant, because he's selling the miracle. He's not simply giving the miracle, he's selling it for money. Right? So that is why he is called the miracle merchant. The title refers to Louis Corset. Okay, so then of course we are told that Jane enters, enter Jane Doe Center. Okay, Jane, good morning, Louis. Louis rising, so he was sitting down, he rises from his chair. He says, good morning, Jane. Jane, go on with your breakfast. I've had mine, but I'll just have a cup of coffee to keep you company. Helps herself. Is there any toast left? Now, here again, we are talking about the breakfast table. Remember the breakfast table, that it is full of food and drink and tea or coffee. And we are told that as they are sitting down, Louis had not had his breakfast, but as he's sitting down, he's having his breakfast. Jane joins him and Jane tells him, you know what, I will sit down and keep you company. I've already had my breakfast. Okay, so I'm just going to sit down and do nothing. Okay, but I'll have a cup of coffee. So while I'm sitting down and since you're eating, I'm just going to have something light, that is a cup of coffee. Okay, and as she says that, the very next moment we are told that she says, is there any toast left? Now this woman has already had her breakfast and she said that she's not hungry and that she doesn't want to eat anything, but now she's asking for toast. So Louis, he says, Sturridge is bringing some. Here it comes. So Sturridge is the butler. Sturridge brings the toast and he keeps it. So Sturridge enters left with a toast rack. Jane seats herself and is helped to toast. She takes three pieces. Okay. Remember, she has already had a breakfast, right? And she had said that she only wants coffee, but now she's eating toasts. That took three pieces of it. Then Jane, isn't there any butter? Sturridge says, your sleeve is in the butter, miss. Okay. It's a very funny scene, actually, the way she's so greedy and also she's so foolish and she's so stupid because she doesn't have her manners, and you know, it's just that she should not have been behaving in that manner, especially because she's a guest at Mrs. Bowwhistle's house and she's already had her breakfast, but here, and she says that she doesn't need more food. But here again, she's sitting down and she's eating very greedily again. And she takes the toast and she wants butter with it. And the butter is right next to her, that her dress sleeves are falling in the butter. Okay, it's just the dish is right next to where she's sitting. But she's so engrossed with all the food that is on the table that she doesn't even see it. So Sturridge says that the sleeve is in the butter. And Jane says, oh yes. And we are told she helps herself generously. So she takes a lot of the butter and she applies it on the toast and she eats that as well. So this woman can really eat. That is what is clear to us. Sturridge, on the other hand, he exits and he goes into the kitchen. Mrs. Bowwhistle, we are told, Jane dear, I see the Mackenzie Hubbard wedding is on Thursday next. St. Peter's, Eaton Square. Such a pretty church for weddings. I suppose you'll be wanting to run away from us to attend it. You were always such friends with Louis Hubbard. It would hardly do for you not to turn up. Okay. Now the auntie is trying her level best to convince Jane Martlet to leave her house before Thursday. And of course, I told you, she has to be polite. She can't be rude and just say get out. Right? After all, that's a guest. So she says Jane that there is a wedding going on and the wedding is of Louis Hubbard, who is a friend of Jane's. And the wedding is at St. Peter's Church at Eaton Square. Okay. And the wedding is very luckily for her, the wedding is on Thursday, the same day that Dora Bittles is about to come. Okay. So Mrs. Bovisel kind of reminds her, she says, you know, you all are very good friends. I'm sure you would want to go for the wedding on Thursday. And, you know, it will not look good if you don't go for your own friend's wedding. Okay. So Jane says, oh, I'm not going to bother to go all that way for a silly wedding. Much as I like Lewis, I shall go and stay with her for several weeks after she's come back from her honeymoon. And obviously this woman is impossible because she says, I'm not going for it. I don't want to go for the wedding. And even if I like Lewis very much, Lewis is, and this again is a different Lewis. This Lewis is a female. Do not confuse this Lewis with Lewis Corsett, who is a character in the play. This is just a friend of Jane who is getting married, right? But it's the same name. But this is a female friend. Yes, so we are told that she says, I'm going to visit Lewis once she comes back from her honeymoon. Okay, and Lewis, this is the nephew, Lewis grins across at his aunt. So he's laughing because he knows that his aunt tried a technique or tried a trick to get Jane out of the house before Thursday, but the trick was a flop because Jane was not ready to listen and she says, I'm not going to leave and I'm not even going to go for the wedding. Okay, and then Jane continues with her food. She says, I don't see any honey. Now she wants honey along with the butter. For her toast, she also wants honey. So this is her second breakfast and she is not even ashamed of the fact that she's eating so much and there are people watching her, and of course this is not her house. And Lewis, he teases her and he says, your sleeve is in the honey. So you're next to you, right next to you. You're looking too far, right next to you. Your other sleeve is in the honey. The first sleeve was in the butter next to her hand, and next to the other hand her sleeve is falling in the honey. So it's just trying to show you that she's so greedy for food, and you know, she just does not even look at what is right around her. She's looking at everything else which is far away, and that's why she can't see the honey and the butter. Okay. And then Jane says, bother, so it is. And she helps herself liberally, so that also she takes a lot of it and she puts it on the toast and she's eating that also. Mrs. Bovisel's rising, so she gets up from the table. She says, well, I must leave you and go do some gardening. Ring for anything you want, Jane. So Mrs. Bovisel, you know, being that very generous host, she doesn't condemn, or she does not, criticize Jane in any way. Okay, so she's just very generous and she says, if you want anything more, if you want more food or anything, just ring. You know, just call for me, send some servant, they will come and I'll come back to you. Whatever you want, do not hesitate to ask me. And Jane says, thank you, I'm all right. Exit Mrs. Bovisel by the French window right. So remember, French windows are not really windows. They're mostly long enough to be doors. And with a glass, it has glass and wood. And usually French windows are used, you know, for a entry point to the garden. Okay, so we are told that she goes to the garden and through that French window, and that French window is on the right hand side of the stage. Then Lewis, pushing back his chair, now they are alone, Lewis and Jane are alone, so he says, do you mind my smoking? So he wants to smoke, so he is asking for permission. And Jane is still eating heartily, she's got a mouth full of all the food, and she says, not at all. Okay, I don't mind you smoking at all. Now, enter Sturridge with a tray left as if to clear away breakfast things. Places tray on the side table, back center. Is about to retire. Oh, I say, can I have some more hot milk? This is nearly cold. So, Sturridge has come to almost empty the table and take back everything in, but Jane Martlet is still not finished eating. Her second breakfast this is. Okay, and she tells him, please, can I have some more hot milk? Because whatever milk is there on this table is already gone cold. Can you get me some more milk, which is hot? So Sturridge takes a jug and exits left. Lewis looks fixedly after him, seats himself near Jane and stares solemnly at the floor. Now this is where it gets a little interesting. Lewis looks fixedly after him simply means that he's staring at Sturridge. For some reason, he stares at Sturridge, and it becomes very clear to us that he's getting an idea that revolves around Sturridge. Okay, so that's why he looks at him for a very long time, and then he's taking his time to think about his idea. And then he sits himself near Jane and stares solemnly at the floor. So he's still thinking, he's still inventing that whole idea and the trick that he wishes to use in order to get Jane Martlet out of the house. So he's very seriously he is staring at the floor. Okay, and yes, the first thing that he says is servants are a bit of a nuisance. Okay, so you know where this is going to go, but we will stop here for today's class, and we'll see what trick Lewis will use to get Jane Martlet out of the house, and whether or not that trick will be a success, because his aunt has already tried one trick. It's a very good trick, but it does not work with Jane Martlet. So we know that Jane Martlet is a very difficult character. You can't convince her very easily. She has her own ways of doing things, and she'll keep doing the same thing, or whatever it is that she wants. Okay, so will Lewis succeed in giving his aunt a miracle or not? Okay.